Hello, everybody. Welcome back to Mondays with Mover. I'm Mover, CW Lemoine, author of the Spectre series and the Alex Shepard series. We've got an exciting two-part episode for you today. I'm interviewing a U-2 pilot, a good friend of mine I've known for, quite a few years now. He has joined me via Skype, and you'll get to hear his story of how he became a U-2 pilot. So today is part one, and then next week we'll do part two, because it's kind of a long conversation, but a lot of good information. I really appreciate it. He goes by Splint, and he'll be telling the story. So without further ado, here it is. I'm here with Splint, former KC-10 pilot, current U-2 pilot, and good friend of the channel. He's here to tell his story on how he became a U-2 pilot. Tell me about how you got, so you went to OTS or ROTC?
Yeah, I was an OTS guy. So I actually went to college, got a business degree, and kind of a roundabout way to end up into a cockpit. But originally I thought I was going to become a Marine fighter pilot and went to Marine OCS. Mm-hmm. And boot camp there, OCS out at Quantico, got some stress fractures, and was disenrolled from the course about 3 or 4 weeks in. So it is a rough course. So thought my dreams of flying airplanes was over junior year of college. So continued, went and worked for a major tech company out of once I graduated. And then from there, decided I didn't really like my job, quit. Right in the middle of the height of the recession in 2008, which was pretty crazy. So 23 years old, not really understanding the world, but just understanding that I did not like what I was doing. So I was getting a pilot's license at the time. The boss I was working for was not wanting to be too flexible with my vacation time. So with that, I got pretty upset, not intending to quit work that day, but I ended up out on the job, which was, looking back, it was a gutsy move, not really having any plan whatsoever.
Yeah.
But yeah, I'm glad it worked out, but it is something that was, looking back, I didn't really think that one through too well, but continued to finish my private pilot's license, got that, and then decided, you know what, I'm going to give this another shot. So I went to an officer training school recruiter, OTS recruiter, out in Texas. And from there, went through all the application process, taking the FOQT, taking the TBAS test, all that stuff, applying and getting selected and attending OTS. So
what'd you get your degree in?
I got my degree in business marketing. So that's a question you get at every air show. You yep. just get from everybody. Oh, so you're an engineer, right? It's, or some sort of science background. No, that is completely false. So there are certain reasons why you would want to do that, potentially, if you're like test pilot school or something like
right.
But be a pilot, you know, it's, just a business marketing degree.
So you applied, you got your pilot slot through OTS. How was the OTS process? Was that pretty tough?
OTS, yeah. No, it's great. The process, it can be frustrating at times. As with any job, there are people that are, not going to say the political way, but I guess there's people that are passionate about what they're doing, and then there's people that are there just to collect the paycheck, right? So when I first started the process, I definitely felt like I was kind of almost getting the runaround or not really I was having to do a lot more than I thought that I would have to do to join the military, in the sense of, you know, trying to get people to answer their phones. So I would drive, 45, 50 minutes one way or just to go talk to my recruiter because they wouldn't pick up the phone.
Good Lord.
So, there's multiple times where I was driving almost 2 hours a day just to get my recruiter to talk to me and to get paperwork stuff and all that stuff moving. So biggest thing I could tell people is don't get discouraged.
Yeah.
If going through this process, it might not go as smoothly as you think it's going to, but how bad do you want to do this? If you want it, you know, unfortunately, sometimes you might have to do a little bit of extra work.
You make them tell you no, yeah. Did you have any issues with the medical side and getting through all the?
Yeah, exactly. So because I had actually been disenrolled from Marine Corps OCS from the stress fractures, they had to go do waivers and stuff for me, which was not an issue. But waivers are obviously, as I'm sure, I think you've talked about it in your previous videos, but there's a waiver for just about everything in the military. So like you say, make them tell you no. So show up and they gave me a waiver, all that stuff. And then just went through standard MEPS process, got my flight physical after being selected, all that, and then attending OTS.
Yeah. So OTS, you had your pilot slot going in, right? So when you're in active duty off the street, OTS, you knew from day one. Did you know you were going to NGEPT at that point?
No. Did not know I was going to go to NGEPT, but correct with knowing you are going to go to become a pilot. So when I was applying, they asked me what rated positions I wanted to apply for, and I told them specifically pilot.
Yeah.
They suggested, you know, I'm sure you've heard it a million times. They're always going to tell you, apply to everything else. And if all you want to do is fly and you don't care what position it is, or you want a job, you want to be an officer, then absolutely apply for all the rated career fields. I have friends in all the different positions, and they're running successful careers in all the different, avenues of rated officers. So if that's something you want to do, by all means, go for it. But for me, I knew I wanted to be a pilot, so that was what I was going to apply for, and that's what I did. So I did know that I was going to become a pilot before.
So you went to, how did you get NGEPT? Was that just a selection process? And for the kids at home, what is NGEPT?
Sure, NGEPT is a Euro-NATO Joint Jet Pilot Training. So it's a pilot training out at Shepherd Air Force Base. And a lot of our NATO partners send all of their student pilots to come train out in Wichita Falls. Where primarily it's going to be a strike fighter type or fighter bomber track is traditionally what it's been. It's not always been that way for the last few years, or actually since I've gone through and before that, right? But the traditional, the old way was primarily you go there, then you end up going to fighters. The unique thing about it is you'll go from T-6s to T-38s, so there's no real track to collect. You're pretty much going to go there. You're going to get a little bit more flight time, I think, than the other UPT bases. And, it's a great training program. But as far as attending it, at OTS, there's a board that you'll meet. So you'll be competing at OTS. Meet a board, and you're going to put an application, and you'll be interviewed. And I don't know if the process has changed. I imagine it probably has not. But, you just apply and hopefully you get selected.
So back in the day, that used to be a guaranteed. If you tracked to NGEPT, you knew I'm going to go fighters as long as I don't wash out, right? So but back in your day, that's about when things started changing, right?
Maybe a little bit before me, but it was definitely changing. So the classes of however many, there would be, the majority would get fighters or bombers or something like that. And then, for my particular class, we ended up with two fighters for our class. And I think we had 14 assignables. So, the numbers, it's different. Right? So, it's one of those things where you can build it up and you can plan for everything and you can do your best. And something really important I actually want to talk about is when you are competing at UPT, just remember, you're not competing against everyone else. You're competing against yourself.
Yep.
So definitely want to make sure that people that are going to pilot training understand that, because you are not going to be affecting how someone else is going to go fly a jet, and you aren't going to affect how they study. You can only control yourself. So that's one of those things where, kind of looking back on it, you're like, oh, I'm competing against so-and-so, or, you're looking at how everyone else is doing. It's all just wasted thoughts. Yeah.
And you learn more by helping each other, right? I mean, absolutely. Cooperate to graduate. Yeah.
100%, man. And really, you got to look back on it, and I still talk to all these, you know, I was just actually talking to one of my my good friends from pilot training today, and you know, yeah, you end up making friends for life in that program, so you don't go burn bridges and stuff. So yeah, it's yeah, I think it is really important to, you know, make sure you're working together and understand that you're one big team. And honestly, when you look at it, the needs of the Air Force, as fun as it is, but it really is, that's ultimately everything. So
you go to NGEPT, and you know, you're in the mindset of probably going to get fighters, and then your career kind of takes that hard right, and you get, how did assignment night go for you?
Man, you know, it's really funny because before we get our assignments, they have kind of like a career day where, you know, all the people from all the different communities come in, they're instructor pilots that had flown previous whatever airframe, and they come and talk to us about, hey, here's what it's like to be in this community, here's what this is like, so on and so forth. And, you know, I was actually kind of torn looking through it, because when looking back, the definitely wanted to fly fighters and love the idea of that, and you know, obviously it didn't work out, but it's okay, you know, I can't complain. But the big thing is when I filled out my dream sheet, I was kind of torn whether I wanted to go live the lifestyle of a fighter pilot, because I don't think a lot of people truly understand what it is to be a fighter pilot. You can watch YouTube videos all day.
Yeah.
And you could go watch Top Gun like we all did, which is why we're all pilots now, right? I mean, but I don't think very many people understand how much work it is to be a fighter pilot. So, so after we got those briefs and listening and talking to everybody, I'm thinking like, man, this was, you know, this was kind of a kick in the junk. Pilot. And they're like, yeah, if you think this is hard, wait till you end up in your F-16, you know, RTU and all the other stuff and upgrades. I'm like, man, you know, I don't know. But that being said, I was at Shepherd. You know, I had applied to that. I competed for that. I felt I at least owed it to myself to put all the fighters first and just see how the cards fell, right?
Yeah.
But I wasn't at that point in time. I was like, you know, I'll be okay with wherever we end up. So put down actually the I had all the heavies and whatnot, and actually had KC-10s up fairly high because my dad was actually a KC-10 pilot. So he flew them when they were brand new, flying them off the line. So he was like, oh yeah, they're great, you know. And then actually down the road, it turns out they aren't as nice as they were when they were off the factory. But that being said, it's still a fantastic airplane. So yeah, assignment night comes out, and yeah, you know, you're standing up there in front of everybody, and it's kind of a nerve-wracking type thing, because I mean, like, your future is literally on a PowerPoint slide that's about to drop, and you know, the whole base is there, everyone's, you know, pulling for you. And you know, I've got a KC-10 pulls up, and they're like, hey, and then you're going to Travis. So I'm like, man, you know, end up in California, go to the West Coast, and, you know, travel the world. I was actually pretty stoked. So
good.
I was pretty happy about that, and told my dad, and he was just like, oh my gosh, I can't believe it. Their whole life, my dad was trying to end up, my mom and dad wanted to live on the West Coast, and they're like, dude, you get this out of your first assignment, you know, this is, yeah, that's pretty awesome. So I was really stoked. But yeah, so that's how assignment night went, and yeah, off I went to the KC-10 out in Travis.
So then you went to the KC-10 and you did really well, right? I mean, it was something you enjoyed doing, and you know, you just talk about how you dealt with that. You know, I mean, obviously, okay, you go to NGEP, you're thinking fighters, you kind of, you know, transition to the heavy mindset. A lot of guys show up and they are bitter. Right? They show up and they thought they were going to get fighters, and they're pretty bitter about being where they are.
Yeah, that's certainly a thing. So, the, you know, attitude is everything. It really is. And I was going to go there and make the most of it. So, I honestly went there, and I didn't talk very much at all about where I went to pilot training, because I didn't want to have that stigma, or, you know, because in general, at NGEP, you know, it's kind of got a name, oh, you know, you went to whatever. But it's end of the day, it's pilot training, and we all did the same thing, so whatever. But when I was out there, yeah, so I tried to not talk about flying T-38s, and, you know, just I was just another another person in the pipeline going through training, and just wanted to do my best and try to have the best impact I could in the squadron. So, as far as doing well there, I mean, I did my job, right? So was a first officer, or not first officer, but pilot. First officer maybe down the road, thinking of that. But co-pilot, you know, starting out, brand new lieutenant, and got several deployments. And then after so many deployments, ended up going to aircraft commander upgrade, and then finished up out there as an aircraft commander. Yeah. And like a flight commander in the squadron. But yeah, the it's funny because, you know, you go to Shepherd, and the whole time they're teaching you single seat mindset the entire time, because the intent is you're going to go fly fighters, and you're going to be a single seat type person, right? And then I had to go to the KC-10, and it's interesting, you know, people, hey, tell someone to get your gear, and it's like you want to do all these things, but you understand that, there's a reason why heavies are flown the way that they're flown, and it's for good reason. So, learning the crew concept, that mentality and all that stuff actually was really good. I really grew to enjoy having flight engineers there, and boom operators are always a riot. They're, they bring the party, some of my favorite people. But, it was I really, really look back at my time with the KC-10, with my crews, my friends, people I still talk to all the time. And I really actually, looking back, it couldn't have gone any better. I'm very happy with how things turned out. So while initially you may be a little bit disappointed, just realize that after you're done flying, whatever it is, you know, you're going to get a picture, you'll get your litho and stuff on the wall, and you're just going to look at that, and that's what you did, right? But what lasts are the friends that you make in those squadrons, and the people are truly what make the Air Force so good, and make actually, your squadron and your experience so great. So that's what I look back on the most, even though I did enjoy flying the KC-10. For a heavy jet, it flies really nice. It's a really nice flying airplane, and cool missions, and got to see some really cool things, and the just going out, flying over Afghanistan, flying over Iraq, and delivering fuel to fighters and fighter pilots like you, out there hacking the mission. It's really rewarding when you're able to see the results of what the close air support was able to do as far as saving lives and everything on the ground. So seeing where you fit into that is actually pretty cool. Yeah, it ended up working out pretty awesome.
How'd you get from a KC-10 to a U-2?
Yeah, I honestly hadn't really thought about applying to the U-2. The big thing was where we were deployed in the KC-10, there also happened to be U-2s. So on one of my, I think it's my fifth deployment out there, I was hanging out at the Camel, which is a place we'd all hang out with, and drink and grab our three beers or whatever. And I got to talking with some of the U-2 guys, and they, the desert, it is what it is, right? It's we can all complain, but someone always has it worse. So as far as the Air Force goes, we have it pretty good. But when you're out there all the time, it gets kind of annoying. But anyways, I'm out there thinking, man, how are these U-2 pilots so happy out here? And they just seem to be having the time of their life, and they're talking about what the community is like and all this other stuff. And beyond the flying, which obviously is going to be really good, it's also you look for things that quality of life, and it'll make more sense once you're in. But they all seem to have a pretty high quality of life and really enjoyed what they're doing. So went out there actually and visited, because one of our KC-10 pilots had recently applied and gotten hired. So he invited me out, and I went and checked it out. And, wow, this is actually a really, really cool squadron, and a lot of really cool history and all that. So, and I'm going to apply. Let's see what happens. So applied and, went out there and visited, and got a call actually, was it like 2 days, I think, before I was going to go on another deployment, that the recruiter called and said, hey, we want you to come out and interview. So I couldn't believe it. So it was crazy. So got to go out there. When I was flying out to the desert, I actually took a U-2 pilot who was going out there, so I got to talk to him about the interview, and he was a great dude, gave me a ton of good gauge and what to expect and whatnot. So we talked throughout the entire deployment, came back, and yeah, it's a 2-week interview process. It's pretty wild, right? So what they don't tell the whole interview process and everything, it's you're pretty well screened before you even get the call to come out there. So there's a lot of applicants, and it's pretty picky on what we're looking for specifically. Primarily, you need a minimum of 1,200 flight hours to apply. I believe it's 400 hours. I think it's for fighter type is what you need, and then you gotta be at least an aircraft commander for a year, or have, I believe, 400 hours as an aircraft commander. There's all the specifics. These are off the top of my head. I'd have to pull up the sheet, but it's all out there if anyone's looking to apply. But yeah, so after you meet, that's why you don't actually go to the U-2 straight out of pilot training. There's just no possible way. We want people to have experience. So anyways, 2-week interview process. First week is primarily meeting with bosses, commanders. You're in service dress, and it's like an interview, why are you here? That type of stuff. I won't get into the specifics because some of that we got to keep sacred, and they're going to come out there. I can't have them knowing all the answers, but it's the first week is pretty much a lot of that. And then, us getting to know them and them getting to know us. Right. So it's an interview for both sides of the table, because once you come to the U-2, you're pretty much going to be there for the rest of your career. Wow. So, yeah, you really want to make sure that this is what you want to do before you say, yeah, this is it. And there's nothing wrong with it. We have people that will, just drop, hey, this wasn't what I thought it was, and no harm, no foul. That's fine. So,
wow. Is the suit hard to get used to flying with that?
Yeah, that's actually part of the interview. So, the very end of the first week, you get fitted into a suit, and they give you a claustrophobia check. So you actually get put in the suit and put the visor down, and yeah, it's pretty crazy. The first breath you take once the visor comes down was kind of weird. I'm kind of freaked out a little bit. I was like, uh-oh. And then kind of calmed down, and then, all right, this maybe it's not so bad. But yeah, so there's plenty of people that right after that, we had one not too long ago, actually, that the suit was just no good for him, and he quit right there. So, better to find out there than hire them, and then, months down the road, hey, I don't like this, So that's part of that. And then going to the last week is 3 flights. It's going to be basically they all kind of building block, but we're looking for a positive trend upward after each flight, that you're able to receive instruction and then apply what our instructor is evaluating you on, applying the techniques and the procedures, whatnot, how to land this airplane, and making sure that they will be able to finish training within the allotted time, which is only 14 rides.
Oh, wow.
So,
that's pretty quick.
But yeah, so it's from what I've heard, I think the numbers get thrown all around, but I've heard 50% pass rate about. So,
jeez,
yeah. So there's no real rhyme or reason, man. And we've had fighter pilots that couldn't do it, and we've had but we've got everything pretty much represented. We had a recently, not too long ago, had an F-14 pilot. F-14 pilot. We hired Navy pilots. We just hired a couple Marines, Harrier pilots. Came out, so we've got just about everything represented, so no real guaranteed track to come here. It's just you're just gonna have it. So but yeah, as far as going back to your question about flying the suit, yeah, it's you get used to it. It's never, it is weird. There's just weird things that you would never really think about, just some things you take for granted, like being able to scratch your face, right? So
right.
Yeah, you can't, because obviously you've got your whole face covered. So the you could take the drinking straw, kind of wedge it in there, and then kind of move your face around. It's yeah, or just try not to think about it and hope it goes away. little things like that. How do you drink? Yeah, it looks like hamster bottles. There's some pretty good videos on YouTube that show kind of what it looks like. But it's like a hamster bottle, and it has a little drinking tube and fits into a port on your helmet. And then food, yeah, we eat two foods, so that's kind of interesting. Wow. It's surprisingly pretty good. People think it's going to be like baby food consistency, but there's actually texture. I believe back in the past it was, from what I've heard, I think baby food type consistency, and the pilots were complaining of it naturally. So they actually put texture. So for example, there's a key lime pie, and you can actually, there's bits of crust. So, I mean, it's actually, yeah, it'll fit through the straw and everything, but there's still bits of crust that you could kind of crunch on. And, wow. Yeah, there's chicken tortilla soup with shredded chicken. And I mean, it's surprisingly not bad. Or maybe I'm just really hungry up there. I don't know. But yeah, it's not too bad, actually.
So people are going to ask about piddle packs. I guess piddle packs aren't really an option.
Yeah, actually, yeah, we have piddle packs. So yeah, there was a recent, it looks funny, man. So you have to have no shame, because you come out of you get dressed in a little room, and you come out essentially looking long johns with, for guys at least, it's got a hole cut out for, you know, for you. And so you fit this thing on, it almost looks, I'd say it's like a condom-esque, except it's rigid.
So it's, and like a type, it's of like catheter,
kind of something like that. Yeah, it's, but it's, yeah, you fit that on, and then it has on the end of it like a connector that connects to the suit, which goes to a tube that goes to a tank in the jet. Yeah, this is a really commonly, this is a common asked question. Because, yeah, how do you go? Because, I mean, 12 hours, right? So obviously you have to. So yeah, you dial up a little bit of pressure in the suit, and then just go. You can't go too fast, or it'll overflow and gets all over you, and it's not fun for everyone involved. But yeah, so got to control the flow. And then it just kind of goes into the tank. And then if you're going to overfill the tank, you, like you said, talking about piddle packs, you actually have to kind of hold a piddle pack down there and then hold the tube so that the tube goes in. It's pretty funny. But and as you're asking about the suit, this is one of those things. So, yeah, this is something you kind of take for granted. It is kind of awkward and kind of weird. But it's you got to go, so... Yeah, so we have a couple of females, and I believe in the program, actually. Well, one right now, I think another's on the way, and I think they have kind of like a pad almost type thing. So I think they're trying to develop something different, so something more efficient. But we just don't have too many female pilots. We've had them, but it's just the numbers are so low that I think they just haven't changed the way they do it. So, but yeah,
so it's a pressure suit, right? Like NASA.
Go ahead.
It's a pressure suit, kind of like, I mean, is it similar to what a NASA astronaut would wear?
Actually, yeah. It's, from what I understand, it's the same ones that the NASA astronauts wear on their way, what they used to wear in the space shuttle on their way up, and imagine it's what they still wear. The suit technicians, it's Physiological Support Division, I believe, PSD, is the suit techs that are at Beale that work on all of our suits, maintain our pressure suits, the helmets, all that stuff. They actually work on the NASA suits too. So the suits, you'll occasionally see the NASA suits there getting worked on. So they are the place to have all the pressure suits worked on. So it's pretty cool.
That's all the time we have for today. Next week, stay tuned for part two of my interview with Splint. I really appreciate him coming out or him being on the channel and sharing his story. A lot of good information. We'll continue that on the next episode. Thanks for watching. We'll see you next time. Excuse me. Oh, no. Oh! Met a lot of them. God.
Usually fly with the doors off. All hot too.
Don't be a douche.
That's rule number one. I can tell you now.